When we see stem cell therapies now becoming a little bit more available in the US, it's generally either taken from maybe somebody's bone marrow or from their fat cells and multiplied. But in your country, it's done differently. And you're able to do it differently by the regulations there.
Yes,
and
correct.
So explain to me a little bit how it is that you do the stem cells and why the stem cells that you guys use are so different from what somebody would use at an American clinic.
Okay, so we have two types of stem cell therapies, we can say. In general, we have autologous therapies, which the name says auto. It's from your own body. Mm-hmm. You withdraw a sample for bone marrow is the most common, or fatty tissue, and you make a process, but it's a fast process in laboratory to obtain a certain amount of stem cells and then put it back to that patient. And then we have allogenic therapy, which are donated stem cells, cultivated, expanded, and then processed for clinical applications for therapeutical purposes. Both can show results, but evidence has shown higher results and better results with allogenic therapies, because we have what is called histocompatibility risk out of the way. That means that histocompatibility is when a tissue is compatible with another tissue, right? So there's no rejection with donated stem cells because of the safety or biosafety processes and the quality processes done in laboratory to assure that that donated cell does not carry what is called an HLA receptor, which is human leukocyte antigen. It's like I always tell my patients, it's like the waving flag that comes in somewhere. If it's a foreign flag, of course, it's strange. Let's attack it. But stem cells do not carry that flag. They do not even carry any flag. Mm. So when they get into your body, instead of our immune system rejecting it, it will happen the other way around. It'll stimulate our immune system and regulate it.
So a lot of people, when they hear about the idea of getting stem cells donated, essentially from somebody else, and I believe you use either from like placenta or Wharton's jelly. Mm-hmm. Am I correct in saying that?
Yes.
So a lot of people, their first thought is, well, am I going to have some weird reaction to that? Because it's coming from somebody else. Is there going to be an autoimmune reaction? But what you're saying is there's actually a positive effect because these stem cells don't carry DNA markers?
That is correct. Even like you would be scared of getting what is called graft versus host disease,
right?
Which is that if something foreign and your body overreacting it, like a donated liver. In here, actually, stem cells in several parts of the world, like for example, New Zealand, stem cells are authorized for graft to treat graft versus host disease. So you can have an idea on how wrong that could be.
Yeah.
And of course, it's a regular thing to be afraid of, because we're not acknowledged throughout our life about this. This is new.
Right. We don't grow up learning in school about how stem cells work, and like it's not a part of the education.
Even my colleagues, a lot of medical experts, are not aware or just don't get into the subjects. So they are not aware of the benefits or the scopes and limitations, everything. Like any other therapy, it has its scopes and limitations, of course. And the difference between here in the US, we would say, is that we're only allowed to do autologous, and you can only get a certain amount of stem cells from that process. So stem cell research towards treatments towards different diseases have grown tremendously in the last 10 years, four times faster than they have done in 15 years prior to that. Because all medical fields are in constant growth and in constant research, mm-hmm. but we can say that this medical field isn't diapers, because we've been at it for 40 years. Dr. Frankenstein in 72 first described this weird cell, and then it was figured, or it was discovered that it was a stem cell. And then until 92, Dr. Arnold Kaplan described the mechanism of a stem cell, how it works, where can they be, the parasite theory, the naming of mesenchymal stem cells based on their functioning. We've been researching and investigating clinical applications and benefits that we can use this fascinating cells towards benefiting patients. So let me rephrase it. We're still in growth. We're always still in growth towards this, but now we understand a lot of mechanisms of stem cells, which we can provide patients a new opportunity and a new improvement, not only where there are no options, but also as a coadjuvant therapy, integrative approach. This is not an alternative therapy. You can use it or indicate it to your patient along with the regular therapy. A diabetic patient can take it along with insulin, along with hypertensive patient or a high blood pressure patient can take it along with his antihypertensives. I mean, there are just very few contraindications with this therapy, so they're pretty safe, and we can even expect or give the patient the opportunity to reduce their regular medication intake.
Mm. And one thing we touched on a little bit earlier, but I just wanted to clarify a little more, is that when you're comparing the somebody getting stem cells from their own fat or from their own bone marrow versus getting a donor stem cells, and the donor would typically be somebody substantially younger than the recipient, is there a big difference in here in the quality of the stem cells because of the age?
Yes, definitely. So let's put a scenario, a great example. We're treating a 60-year-old person with chronicity of 20 years diabetic, now with grade 3 kidney failure, chronic kidney failure. And we're obtaining that patient's own stem cells, processing them and applying them back. Stem cell signaling and stem cell quality also ages with us. So of course that person's autologous therapy is not going to be as efficient as an allogenic therapy where we processed an under 30 young age woman with the proper screening, making sure that they don't have any chronic diseases running in the family, any chromosomal alterations, any oncogenetic alterations, and then making sure and doing all those biosafety processes to the stem cell during the whole process of expansion. And by expansion, I mean the stem cells have the capacity of proliferating, growing one after another. Of course, that we have to keep it at a certain rate to homologate the quality, but this way we assure that that stem cell that we're using for therapeutical purposes fulfills all the international requirements and releases all the proper signalings and soluble molecules to carry out an effective therapy. Mm. And of course, in a safe manner.
Yeah, and what I love is when somebody is getting stem cells done with you, a part of what they get is the complete laboratory analysis.
Oh,
of
yes.
Those cells, which is always very cool.
What we just mentioned, there is a quality certificate that shows the donor, the studies made to that donor, which is the first process of biosafety. And once we obtain the tissue, which is mainly umbilical cord and placenta, then we go to the second process of biosafety, which is in laboratory, flux cytometry, hoist tension, which is a tension that is done every certain period of time to assure that there's nothing else growing in there. If you harvest and put stem cells in an environment that is made to grow with nutrition, anything can grow in there, bacteria, fungus, virus. So the laboratory has to have the correct controlled environment to assure no contamination, and we also have to keep a good eye on that, making those tensions to see that nothing else is growing in there. And you get a quality certificate showing all of those processes with the batch number that you're getting the stem cells from, processed into the vial for application purposes, and an official document, of course.